Broadcasting live.
It's America's longest running talk show on computers. It's Computer America, bringing you the biggest names in technology with guest interviews, new products, and your emails. Listen live at ComputerAmerica.com
on any device around the world.
Email the show at live@ComputerAmerica.com or find us on social media.
Be sure to check out our website for contests, giveaways, show notes, live video stream, podcasts, and more.
You're listening to Computer America.
Hello and welcome everyone into the Computer America Show. We are the nation's longest running nationally syndicated radio talk show on computers and technology, and the coffee has not kicked in yet. Everyone, welcome into the program. I hope that you're doing well and you are ready for today's program. So today on the show, we of course have Ralph Bond. He is our science and technology trends correspondent, though looking at today's stories, might as well rename him our science fiction technology trends correspondent, because a lot of what we're going to talk about seems like science fiction. It's crazy. It's a very future-packed kind of set of stories, but they're all real. They're all, hey, you can go check them out yourself, and that brings us to the show notes. That will be posted on ComputerAmerica.com. That will have everything, including links, topics. Of course, you can see the archives of the show after the fact, the podcast, the video, so on and so forth, and of course, all of Ralph's segments in one convenient spot there at the top of the page. But even beyond that, you can go over to Ralph's site and check out everything that Ralph does. Now, with that being said, let's see, ComputerAmerica.com, check that out for social media links. I'm still on the fence. I probably should, and if I haven't created it already, or if it has not been created already, I should probably create a Computer America Threads account, because I know that it's getting a lot of what I think to be paid promotion. There's a lot of news stories covering it, but or maybe it's just a really, really slow week and everyone's just giving it ultimate, kind of promotional status. But yeah, maybe Computer America might have a Threads account. But I mean, I don't know. Our Twitter account is, not the most exciting thing in the world. And I don't know. Twitter's just so kind of hard to get into. It's not what it was. And I don't know. It's hard finding the fun people. But either way, Computer America Threads. I'll let everyone know by next week. I'll make a definitive decision, yes or no. Facebook's going to take over the world one way or the other. Might as well kind of get ahead of it a little bit. But everyone, hey, that's neither here nor there. Let's go ahead, bring on Ralph, and have fun with it. So as I said before, science and technology trends correspondent. He covers everything that science and technology touches. And well, that's a lot of what you hear about today, but he does a great job of finding stories that you probably haven't heard of. So Ralph, welcome back onto the program. How you doing?
Hey, it's great to be back and talk about being caffeinated. Yes, I'm ready. One by gigantic mug of coffee here. And hey, talking about Threads real quick. Yeah, I'm thinking about that too. The one thing right now is I'd have to put a special app on my Windows PC in order to be able to do postings directly, because it's a Android-based situation, I think, right now, right? And so I could do that. I haven't done that yet, but I think it might be kind of fun to try out. So I'm with you. I think it's worth an experiment.
Yeah, a big part of like why I'm on the fence with Threads is like, I should create an account. Like, regardless, I have a business and we have a social media presence, and right. I should create a social media account. So that just goes without saying. But like, it's billed as an alternative to Twitter, obviously. But it doesn't have nearly as many features as Twitter. So everyone's flocking to it because it's super simple. You go on Instagram or whatever, you get a recommendation link. It fills out all of your information automatically. And with like one, hey, alarm. Sorry, that's me, not you. But with like one link, you can create an account and you're off to the races. The problem, Ralph, I see it, is there's no timeline. There's no hashtags. There's no community. There's no like, I feel like the things that bring people to Twitter, Threads is going to lack in the very beginning. And a lot of people are going to go there, for better or worse, and they're going to look around and go, there's not a lot to do here. And, I'm not sure. Facebook's going to prop it up forever, but I don't know if it's going to really catch on if they don't rush those features out to market.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know. But okay. But all that, either way, ladies and gentlemen, we're here for science and technology trends. And Ralph, yes. Why don't you go ahead and tell the nice folks what it is our mission here today with our stories and in our segment.
Yes, yes. Well, Ben and I do every Friday, most every Friday at least, is we really look at where the world's going in the areas of robotics, medical technology, sustainable energy technology, transportation advances, space research, physics, you name it, all across the board. What I do is I look for really interesting articles, as Ben alluded to, that sometimes just don't get the kind of national or mainstream press attention that they could, because the news cycle is so filled with the war in Ukraine and so many other problems mm-hmm. we're facing these days, fires in Canada, you name it, all that stuff. But what we do is we take each of these stories, we give you kind of the essential top points. It's like a stone skipping across the water, right? And if you want to dive deeper, come out to computeramerica.com, get today's show notes, because in the show notes, we'll have links and images and so on and so forth. And if you want to dive deeper on any of these stories, you can. And today we have a really great mix of stuff that, like Ben said, almost seems like, come on, guys, this can't be real, but it is. And it's pretty exciting. And last but not least, we're going to leave you at the end of the week feeling encouraged and hopeful about the future, thanks to science and technology.
Absolutely. And really, you know, when I was reading through, through the stories, and, you know, it's almost like the promises we've had since like the 1950s, you know, or even before that. So let's go ahead and start with story number one, but I'm really looking forward to things like flying cars and, yes. you know, and just really, really cool science. So, but story number one.
Yes. So story number one, I love this one. Got it from Yahoo News, a story by Katie Wickens. The headline here is Microsoft's light-based computer marks the, quote, unraveling of Moore's Law. Lots to talk about here. But right off the top, you know, when I think of Microsoft, of course, I think of my Windows operating system and my Office 365 and all that groovy stuff.
And of software, course, the Windows right? Phone, yes.
Yeah. All that kind of stuff. But I didn't think about them being involved with basic computer research. So this was a kind of a light bulb moment for me as well that made the story extra interesting as well. So, okay, let's get into the story. Microsoft, more coffee, please. Microsoft is edging ever closer to photon, that's P-H-O-T-O-N, photon computing technology with the analog iterative machine. Of course, the acronym is AIM, but we're going to use the full name. Right now, the light-based machine is being licensed for use in financial institutions to help navigate the endlessly complex data flowing through them. So this is happening now. It's initially just for financial institutions, but stay tuned, right? Well, wait a minute. And here's where I add value, I hope, to these articles. I do these timeouts or reality checks. So timeout, what is photon computing? An optical computer, also called a photonic computer, is a device that uses the photons of invisible light or infrared beams rather than electric current to perform digital computations. And if you have the show notes or get them later, you'll see I always put links for where these nuggets of education come from. So going back to the story, according to the Microsoft Research blog, Microsoft researchers have been developing a new kind of analog optical computer that uses photons and electrons to process continuous value data, unlike today's digital computers that use transistors to crunch through binary data. Okay, another timeout. What is continuous value data? Continuous value data is data that can take any value. Hey, for example, height, weight, temperature, and length are all examples of continuous data. And some continuous data will change over time. For example, the weight of a baby in the first year of its life or the temperature in a room throughout the day. So there's what continuous data is. And so in other words, Microsoft's iterative machine is not limited to the binary ones and zeros that your standard computer is relegated to. Instead, it's been afforded the freedom of the entire light spectrum to work through continuous value data and solve difficult optimization problems. So this is pretty interesting stuff. This is way out there. And the illustrations, especially the one of the diagram you're showing it right now on the screen, is a key part of what we're going to explain here in a moment. So Microsoft explains that normal computers struggle with the sheer volume of data some companies need to process daily because the number of possible combinations explodes exponentially as the problem size grows. And that's that continuous data business. Even with the impressive processing power of high-end CPUs under their belt, the hardware limitations make it virtually impossible to complete such complex work efficiently enough and without costing the world. In other words, you just have to have a massive array or farm of these top-end CPUs. Well,
right.
it's not cost-effective, and it's not even really crunching the data as fast as they'd like. So that's where the analog iterative machine comes in, according to Microsoft. And this analog optical computer can do more, much faster, at the speed of light, in fact. And now let's dive in and give a little bit of context to this. Photons don't interact with one another, but they do leave imprints on the matter through which they pass. That is such a freaky, let that sink in. Photons don't interact with one another, but they do leave imprints on the matter through which they pass. Wow. So the analog iterative machine researchers have been able to use this fact of physics to their advantage. The analog iterative machine throws light. This is what the illustration, second illustration, the notes shows. The analog iterative machine throws light, which passes through several layers, making impressions on each part of what's known as a modular array. It's this process of projecting light through the array that replaces the function of a standard transistor. Okay, let's be honest. This is like mind-melting stuff.
Yeah, it's pretty technical.
Yeah, very technical. And by the way, if you hear any crunching sounds on my side in the background, is my dog with his synthetic bone chewing away.
No, honestly, not picking it up. You're good to go.
Good. Okay, since light-based technologies can perform powerful linear operations and electronic components can work on nonlinear operations, the researchers have been able to combine both optical and electronic analog technologies. That's key. Combining both optical and electronic analog technologies to form a computer that sidesteps the diminishing growth of computing capacity per dollar in digital chips. And my little comment I put in the show notes to clarify, it's not part of the article, but my comment is, wait a minute, Ben, I think they're talking about a hybrid computer. Which yeah. I just think is fascinating. It's like my hybrid RAV4 that's can be most of the time running as an EV, but when I need to, I can switch into traditional hybrid mode, right? Anyway, quick refresh, a linear relationship or linear association is a statistical term used to describe a straight line relationship between two variables. A nonlinear function, a function whose graph is not a line or part of a line. Example, if you inflate a balloon, its volume increases. And by the way, I made a mistake in the show notes. I had a thing about a table below shows the increase of volume, and I didn't right. include that, so I apologize. But anyway, pretty great. So here's the kind of summary. Essentially, the analog iterative machine is making Moore's so-called law look like guidelines. And I had to insert this for folks who may not be familiar with Moore's law. That's the observation. And Gordon Moore is one of the founders of Intel, by the way. Mm-hmm. So Gordon Moore said, it's the observation that the number of transistors in an integrated circuit doubles every 2 years. It's a rough approximation, but what they're saying here is this new world of this hybrid kind of photonic computer is just going to blow away the doors on this whole world and take us into a new place, if it all works out and can be deployable at all yeah, levels of computing. We'll see.
It was not too long ago that we were looking at Moore's Law and thinking, well, this is the end of Moore's Law because we were going to fall behind. You know, we couldn't possibly fit more transistors right. onto a processor. But of course, now they're saying the opposite, where, you know, new technologies give us, you know, the number of transistors is not even comparable to, you know, kind of what we used to do with this new technology in this yeah. article. And yeah. ladies and gentlemen, the very little value that I can add, I will say that all of this is, you know, you may think, oh, wow, I can surf the internet twice as fast, or I can do, you know, XYZ much faster. It's like, no, like, Ralph, there was a point where I think it was like quantum parity. And this is, of course, quantum computing. This is not, you know, photonic computing, which is what right. we're talking about. But like what I always want to highlight to people is that they're, you know, when they claimed that, they created a problem that a traditional computer would have taken it 10,000 years, but a quantum computer, it took it like, you know, a couple hours to do. So you could see where the value was there.
Right.
But what really happened was they phrased the question, like they phrased the problem for the computers in such a way and a little bit of tweaking, and the traditional computer actually beat out the quantum computer after they kind of, you know, rephrased the problem a little bit. So what I'm saying is that these kind, you know, photonic computing, quantum computing, whatever it may be, they won't replace one another, but they will complement one another. And this may be really good for predicting, you know, hurricanes, predicting weather patterns, unlocking the genome and, you know, be able to sequence
yeah.
people's genomes and things like that.
Yeah.
It will have its use cases. It will not replace the phone in your pocket, but it will allow us to do incredible things. So just want to throw that out there. So
Yes. And talking about quantum computing, it'll be a little aspect of a story coming up after the next story about superconductors. So we'll get to that too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. It all comes back around. But speaking of coming back around, and you may remember it from the Jetsons, you may remember it from so many promises, comic books, movies, doesn't matter. One constant for, I guess, pop culture is cars are great, but wouldn't it be great if they could travel in three dimensions, not just, you know, if they could fly, not just forward, straight, left and right. And, you know, the images of this thing are, you know, kind of eye-catching in themselves. I know they're just concept cars, but man, they're so much fun to look at and even more fun to think about the possibilities. But that's just it. It's not just a possibility because you can actually go and get one. Of course, you probably need a pilot's license as well, but hey, that's to be expected. So Ralph, what is story number two?
And you'll need a boatload of money, but we'll get to
that too.
So this story actually got a lot of online mainstream press coverage, but I didn't see it covered on the TV or mainstream radio that I recall. But anyway, the headline here is the first flying car, the Model A, approved by the FAA, and it's 100% electric. And this I got from USA Today. And again, it was covered in many, many other outlets as well. And again, in the show notes, we have links, pictures, all this kind of stuff. Also, another source that I drew from for this story is from Mechical, MECHICAL.com. I have the link for that as well. The images in the show notes are really interesting, and we'll get into that. And there's a video, too, that's in the show notes that's fun to watch. So this week, this is fresh, this week, Aleph, that's A-L-E-F, Aleph Aeronautics, revealed its flying car, the Model A. And if you're a car historian, you know the Model A was a famous Ford car in the 1930s, I think. Anyway, so this week, Aleph Aeronautics revealed its flying car, the Model A, that it was granted legal permission under experimental status from the Federal Aviation Administration to test run the vehicle on the road and in the sky, a move that's needed before it can be released to the public. But we'll get to when it's going to come out to the public if everything goes well. And by the way, I didn't have this in the show notes that you have, Ben, but I just kept thinking, Aleph, is that a person's name or what? Well, Aleph, A-L-E-F, is the first letter in the Hebrew alphabet. Now, whether that's coincidence with this company name or not, I don't know, but it's kind of a fun tidbit. So this is the first time a vehicle, in the traditional sense, a car that parks and drives like a car, functions like a car, looks like a car, kind of. It's a pretty futuristic looking thing. This is the first time it has received special airworthiness certification permission to fly from the FAA. And the certification limits the locations and purposes for which the vehicle is allowed to fly today. And as mentioned in the headline, the Model A is 100% electric, drivable on public roads, and has vertical takeoff and landing capabilities, the company explained in its news announcement this week. Now, in terms of design, this is very interesting design. The car is equipped with 8 propellers, which have been installed inside the body. However, the car can currently carry only 1 or 2 passengers. I think in the video it just shows 1 passenger. While the aim of the company ultimately is to prepare for more passengers in its next phase or stage of product development. And if you're looking at the video or have a chance to see it, it's really kind of interesting because it takes off vertical, you know, up. But right. then the whole car rotates like this, but the cabin is sort of a ball-like thing that counter rotates, so the passenger stays, you know, 90 degrees to the ground, but the yeah. car body turns, and that's how you can go around. So, it's so, just cool so design. The
yeah, yeah, so the person's very stationary, so you don't have to deal with banking yeah. and stuff like that. But yeah, the car, man, that thing is.
Isn't that cool?
It like Ralph, I don't know. Like I look at this and I'm like, why did they even keep the design of the car? That well, I guess because it can still be a car. Is I guess sure, the ultimate sure,
yeah.
point.
Yeah.
But it's so wild looking, like UFO looking. Yes.
Well, yeah, exactly. And here's one thing that I just find impossible to wrap my head around, especially when we talk about its range and it coming up. How in the world can you do this with a battery? Didn't talk about exactly what kind of battery this thing has or how much it weighs, but it's impressive to me that they can pull this off with the battery being such a heavy element, right? So anyway, we'll find out more right. about that as time goes on, I suspect. So under the Code of Federal Regulations, ALEF is required to report any issues, including malfunctions or defects, to the U.S. government agency during the Model A development and testing, which has been is pretty mature and quite on its way. The flying car is now available for pre-order, to your point, Ben, about you can potentially get this thing. The Santa Clara, California-based company posted on its website, the vehicle will sell for, here you go, $300,000. I keep thinking, I need to win Powerball. If I could just win Powerball,
the Powerball would help with fun toys. But I gotta say, if you want a pre-order, $150 yes. for a general pre-order, like a poor person,
that's right.
Or $1,500 gets you priority yeah. queue for the pre-order.
That's right. That's right. And there's your kind of reality. And it's coming, they claim. But another reality check: the car will be a low-speed vehicle. So this is when I went, oh. Okay, meaning it won't go faster than about 25 miles per hour on a paved surface. So this, in my mind, limits its everyday use for, say, a family or something. But I'm going to get into some speculations in a moment. But if a driver needs to a faster route, they will be able to use the vertical takeoff capability to fly, according to the company. But with that 25 miles per hour limit, Ben, I'm starting to think, well, wait a minute. I don't know so much about this vehicle being something that my family or your family or any of our listeners would use on a regular, normal day-to-day basis, because that low speed is such a limiter. But think about maybe security purposes in a facility where you want to go around and be able to, you know, troll or what would be the word, monitor as you're circling, say, a prison or something. I don't know. You pick your application, yeah. but also have the ability to take off. So it could have possible military purposes, possible security surveillance purposes, things that are a little more specialized, that where that low speed ground capability is not a limiter. I think for mainstream usage could be a problem. And then the video, if I recall right, I think opens with a scene showing a San Francisco environment and all these flying cars. You better have an incredible artificial intelligence making sure all these vehicles don't crash into each other, right? So when I mean, you think about the George Jetson scenario, you need mm-hmm. something to keep. If you just willy-nilly start flying around at your own volition, what's going to happen with air traffic? What's going to happen with just other people doing the same thing? How do you control? There you go. That's the video yeah. part I'm talking about. That all looks really nice. Everybody's in a nice little line. Everybody's being nice, but we'll see.
Definitely. Well, I look at that and it's the video is ridiculous on its own right. Like people should go check it out. Yes, there's this part fun. Here where there's a truck. It's, you know, it's tilted over for some reason. It's on a highway. It's not supposed to be on yes. a highway. It can only go 25 miles an hour, and it just, you know, picks up buggers off and just yeah. flies over the wreck. And, you know, for little things like that, like Ralph, that's probably never going to be a thing. Like, I don't think anyone yeah. thinks that, oh, the car in front of me doesn't like, you know, the car in front of them, and they just decide mm-hmm. to take off. You know, mm-hmm. they just fly mm-hmm. off into the sky.
Right.
That's probably mm-hmm. never going to be a thing. Right. I'm thinking, you know, like New York City. Right now, they have, of course, helipads on top of buildings. They right. have, I think you can buy personal, like, they're like oversized drones, but they can carry up to like four people. And they go from designated landing spot to designated landing spot. Ralph, yeah. I think if this vehicle has any hope ever of actually taking flight and being a thing, they're going to need specialized infrastructure that here's where you drive up to. It's a pad you take off from. You go to a designated other pad that you tell it, you know, I'm en route and I'm going to go here. No other vehicle come from there or, you know, kind of intercept me. And it's going to be, it's not going to be the craziness that the video is showing. But
yeah,
there is a use case. You know, maybe for like, let's say a beach, you know, you have this thing, you know, cruising up and down the road, you know, along a beach, someone needs picked up, some, you know, emergency transport, whatever it may be,
lift up,
pick up, go get the person, get back on a road and carry them away. You know, like there are use cases, you're going to need the infrastructure, but the thing that they're selling in this video, Ralph, that's, even if you pay $300,000, even if you get one in your garage, this kind of thing is not possible because it's just not safe. So,
well, and it's that plus the issues of safety in the air and the slow speed on the ground. And by the way, a couple other nuggets here. The version customers could receive as early as 2025, they say, so it's ways off here, would have a driving range of about 200 miles and or a flight range of 110 miles. And when I think about that range and think about the battery, I'm going, wow, I would love to see this thing in person because I would love to just find out how in the heck can you get that vehicle off the ground like, with that kind of battery weight?
I think a lot of it has to do with, you know, if you're watching the video portion, you can kind of see the shape of the vehicle is essentially like a big cage that holds the propellers.
That's right.
So
mesh cage, yeah.
Yeah. So there's really not a lot to it. Like, if you want to get groceries in this thing, you're out of luck, because there's not a lot of storage.
There's no trunk.
Yeah. Exactly. I'm sorry. There's really nothing. But you know, I look at this and I think this is like a very, and I would tell these to, you know, the people creating this, this seems like a very selfish product. It's like, oh, I want to fly. I want to get out of the way. I want to do that. Like, if everyone were to have a vehicle like this, their vehicle would not be able to function because everyone would just be zipping around everywhere and it just would not work. But it's cool.
But it's fun.
It's fun. It's cool. There are applications for it. I think everyone needs one. No, probably not. But it's still a very innovative design. And of course, just the way that it kind of tilts and, you know, the cabin stays completely stationary. It's still very, very cool. So
Yes.
It goes to show someone out there is working on flying cars. I know that's like the thing. It's like, you know, it's like, it's 2023. Where are the flying cars? And it's like, still in beta, you know, they're working on it. So there you go. Story number two, story number three. And, you know, this one is even more so futuristic because, you know, flying cars are all well and good. And, you know, that could, you know, save you 10 minutes on your commute. It's great. Story number three could actually change so much more, including transit. So, Ralph, what's story number three?
Yes, this one's really interesting from a website called The Conversation, which was new to me, so it's a really interesting thing. The headline, though, that caught my attention, of course, is Room Temperature Superconductors Could Revolutionize Electronics. We're going to explain, and this is a little bit super geeky, so get your protective super geek helmet on because this stuff is going to melt your mind, okay? So room temperature supercomputers could revolutionize electronics. It certainly is the case based on what you're going to learn here in a moment. And there's a picture of a magnetic levitating train, and you'll see why in a bit here. But first, this is where I try to jump in and help with these articles, because in this case, the article assumed you understand all this stuff. So first, a definition. A superconductor is a material that conducts direct current without encountering any electrical resistance. Okay. Traditional superconductors must be cooled to extremely low temperatures, close to absolute zero. Superconductors are great, guys, but again, that's one of the problems, this temperature business. Now, superconductors make highly efficient electronics, but the ultra low temperatures and ultra high pressures, air pressure, we'll talk about that in a minute, required to make them work are costly and difficult to implement. Now, room temperature superconductors promise to change all of that. Boy, is that an understatement. The recent announcement by researchers at the University of Rochester of a new material that is a superconductor at room temperature, although it be at high pressure, is an exciting development if proved. So folks, we're talking to talk about trends. This is like real bleeding edge stuff here, okay? Mm-hmm. And if the material, if this material they've come up with at the University of Rochester or one like it works reliably and can be economically mass produced, it could revolutionize electronics. Now, more details here, folks. Get on your geek hat. Here we go. Room temperature superconducting materials would lead to many new possibilities for practical applications, including ultra-efficient electricity grids, ultra-fast and energy-efficient computer chips, and ultra-powerful magnets that can be used to levitate trains and control fusion reactors. And there's even more things we'll talk about. But here's what we need to do. Here's what we need to geek out. So let's talk about high temperature versus room temperature superconductors, okay? In recent decades, researchers have developed so-called high-temperature superconductors, which only have to be chilled to minus 10 degrees Fahrenheit or minus 23 Celsius for the rest of the world here.
That's actually not bad.
No, that's not bad. But here comes the clinker. Though easier to work with than traditional superconductors, high-temperature superconductors, the ones we have today or have had today up until this date, so high-temperature superconductors still require special thermal equipment. Now, in addition to cold temperatures, which, as you say, not too bad, these materials require very high pressure. Get ready, 1.67 million times more than atmospheric pressure of 14.6 pounds per square inch, which is one bar. So, okay, they run at, you know, minus 10 degrees Fahrenheit. That's okay. I can live with that. But I got to figure out a way to have 1.67 million times more atmospheric pressure than,
you know,
what we have. Wow.
I got a guy with a sub that could probably help you with a little bit of pressure.
I'm sorry.
That was bad.
Please. I get it. No, you're right. There are pressures, a serious thing. Okay, so as the name suggests, here's the big excitement. Excuse me. As the name suggests, room temperature superconductors don't need special equipment to cool them. What? Wow. They do need to be pressurized, but get this, only to a level that's 10,000 times more than atmospheric pressure, as opposed to 1.67 million times more. Wow. So room temperature, no special cooling equipment. And yeah, we got to pressurize this thing, but only to 10,000 times more than atmospheric pressure. And this pressure can be achieved by using strong metallic casings. Let all this sink in. This is profound. Wow, what a breakthrough. Room temperature superconductors would remove many of the challenges associated with the high cost of operating superconductor-based circuits and systems and make it easier to use them in the field. So more about what they could do. Room temperature superconductors would enable ultra-high-speed digital interconnects for next-generation computers and low-latency broadband wireless communications. That's curious. They would also enable high-resolution imaging techniques, MRIs, and emerging sensors for biomedical and security applications, materials and structural analysis, and deep space radio astrophysics. Oh, wow, it's all across the board. So other possibilities would include, as we mentioned earlier too, maglev or magnetic levitation trains could operate over longer distances at lower cost. Computers would run faster with orders of magnitude lower power consumption, as I alluded to earlier in the show, said we're going to have something about quantum computing coming up. And quantum computers could be built with many more qubits, enabling them to solve problems that are far beyond the reach of today's most powerful supercomputers. Mm-hmm. But wait, reality check, folks. Whether or how soon this promising future of electronics can be realized depends in part on whether the new room temperature superconductor material can be verified and whether it can be economically mass produced. So, Ben, time and time again, we see these amazing scientific breakthroughs, and salute to the University of Rochester. I'm not in any way dissing this, but the qualifier here, as the article points out, is this is very bleeding edge, early twinkle in the eye stuff. At this stage, it needs to be verified. And the biggest challenge time and time again with these breakthroughs is, can this be economically mass produced and distributed? TBD, let's keep our fingers crossed because this could change the world.
Yeah, but really these breakthroughs, I mean, this is a technology that we will one day unlock. You know, this is something that, you know, it will have applications whenever we do figure it out. It will have applications, like you said, everywhere, deep space, here at home, travel, medicine, security, you know, so like this is something that has to be figured out. And for those watching the video portion, I was showing, this is from, I believe the University of Tel Aviv, but this is a quantum locking. Oh, wow, you know, yeah. This is where, this is what a superconductor kind of looks like, on a magnetic rail. They super cooled the little disc there on this ring.
Yeah.
And the cool part is, like, you know, you can twist it, you can move it, you can set it higher, lower, you can, you know, here they even show that you can even add an obstacle. And it doesn't really matter the, you know, the quantum locking that they do. Like, it's such a cool technology. Like, Ralph, when people talk about, like, levitation, it's not just magnets. This really is, like, full-blown levitation. And there's so many cool applications for it. So, it's something that's going to come, you know, it's going to happen. It's just how long it kind of gets there. It's great to see research that's, you know, that's kind of getting there. So,
yeah,
very, very cool. you know, Ralph, technology like this, like your train can go from, I think, like the world record right now was like 600 miles an hour, something like that. Or no, maybe like 400 miles an hour, 600 kilometers, something like that. This could go, you know, way, 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 way faster. So we'll see.
Pretty cool.
Yeah, we'll definitely see. So, story number three, great research. Story number four, additional research. But this one is, you know, a little bit different. And, you know, we love robotics. Nanorobotics comes up every now and again. Yes. What is this? It's, a new way to kill fungus, which, you know, someone who, you know, just came over a horrible, horrible cold, any way to eliminate illnesses before they get to me sounds like a wonderful thing. Story number four?
Yes, story number four, and for me, has a personal, gross, and disgusting twist, and I'll explain in a moment. So I got this story from medgadget.com, written by Conn, Hastings, one of my favorite authors in the field. And often, folks, we like to end our Friday segments with something in the medical technology world to give us all hope and so forth. But the headline here is Nanorobots release reactive oxygen species to kill fungal biofilms. Okay, that's a mouthful of medical technical garble, blah, blah, blah. We're going to explain everything, folks. And the personal relationship to this is, well, I went to my dermatologist a couple weeks ago after he checked for all of my, you're a redhead white boy growing up on the beach. Guess what happened to you all these years later? Yeah, I've had lots and lots of stuff burned and cut off and everything, all my skin and on and on and on. But I said, hey, doc, you know what? I've got my big toenails kind of gotten weird and crusty and nasty and stuff. He said, oh, let's take a sample. We're going to get a little sample here of what's going on underneath the toenail. We're going to send it off to the lab. Guess what? About a week later, it comes back and says, oh, Ralph, you have a rare fungal thing going on in that toe. And we're going to have to send a special
congratulations.
Custom, isn't that great? And a special custom topical applicant mixture that's going to have to be devised in a lab to meet just your special weirdo rare needs. So this fungal business is very important to me. But with all that personal stuff set aside, again, the headline, Nanorobots release reactive oxygen species to kill fungal biofilms. Let's explain. So fungal infections can be a major challenge, particularly if the infective fungus forms a thick biofilm, which conventional antifungal drugs struggle to penetrate. Currently, antifungal therapies lack the potency and specificity required to quickly and effectively eliminate these pathogens. Now, wait a minute, time out. I had to get some research. What are fungal biofilms? Well, fungal biofilms are communities of adherent cells surrounded by extracellular matrix. These biofilms are commonly found during infection caused by a variety of fungal pathogens. Clinically, biofilm infections can be extremely difficult to eradicate due to their resistance to antifungals and host defenses, your own body's defenses, right? So this is problem. This is why this toenail thing for me has been going on for so long. It's just like, okay. So researchers at the University of Pennsylvania have developed nanorobots that can travel to the site of a fungal infection under the influence of an external magnetic field. And time out for a second here, Ben. You and I have talked time and time again about the emergence in the medical technology field of magnetically guided tiny entities. They're calling them robots. It's a little stretch, in my opinion.
Yeah.
But, you know, delivering medicines, delivering little modules, delivering tiny things through magnetics.
I think we did a story a long time ago about, to help people with infertility, and they had like robots that would actually pick up the sperm and deliver it to the egg and, you know, be able to do that. And like, if you look at that robot, you know, you think like Johnny Five and, you know, RoboCop and like, you know, robot. Like that robot though was like a little microscopic, like little spring looking device. And that's what kind of qualified as a robot. So a robot can be very simple.
And so again, it's for most people, including myself, when I think of robot, I think of the Terminator, or the Boston Dynamics and all those guys. Anyway, so going back here to the story, so they developed nanorobots that can travel to the site of a fungal infection under the influence of an external magnetic field and then bind to the fungal cells and then release something called reactive oxygen species to completely destroy the fungus. Now, the article assumes you're a medical nut and know all this stuff. And I said, wait a minute, I got to know what this. What the heck is a reactive oxygen species? Okay. In chemistry, reactive oxygen species are highly reactive chemicals formed from diatomic oxygen. Examples of reactive oxygen species include peroxides, good old peroxide, right? Mm-hmm. Superoxide, hydroxyl radical, singlet oxygen, and alpha oxygen. Extremely geeky. There's a link in the story here if you want to dive deeper. And then I went, well, wait a minute. They're formed from diatomic oxygen? What's that, right? Well, diatomic oxygen is generated by photosynthesis, the biological process in which water molecules are split using the energy of sunlight. And there's a link if you want to get into that more too. Okay, with all that said,
right,
the tiny nanobot structures, which I would really call just tiny structures, consist of iron oxide nanoparticles that can be tightly controlled using external magnetic fields. So the operator outside the body of the patient is guiding these little guys to the site of the fungal infection. The tiny particles are an example of what's called catalytic nanoparticles. I think that's better than robot, which the researchers at the University of Pennsylvania have dubbed nanozymes. Now, made using iron oxide, as mentioned before, they are maneuverable under the influence of magnetic fields, allowing the researchers to localize them in a specific part of the body. It's targeted, which is so great. In tests so far, the nanorobots have been shown to destroy fungal biofilms, which are particularly difficult, as we mentioned before, using conventional antifungal drugs. The nanorobots also possess another unexpected property, which greatly assists them in their quest to destroy these biofilms, these fungal biofilms. They appear to be highly attracted to fungal cells and will bind tightly within such biofilms, penetrate them, and show less affinity for human cells. In other words, they seem to just naturally sort of avoid the regular, normal, healthy human cells, which greatly enhances their specificity and safety profile. So this was a very geeky thing, folks. I apologize for that. But on the other hand, if you've ever had a fungal infections, you're going to respond to this and think, great help.
I don't really know if this is how it's going to work, but it sounds like they have some kind of cream or some kind of solution where the iron oxide particles are in there combined with the antifungal medication. And then they're going to use magnetic fields. So probably not, you know, the big goofy red magnet from school, but, you know, some kind of machine to, help the medicine penetrate deeper into the fungal infection. It doesn't just get the top layer and you have to kind of reapply. It's going to penetrate deeply into the fungus and hopefully treated much faster and much sooner than traditional treatments.
Right. My guess is it might be, and they didn't indicate this in the article, come to think of it, but maybe it's some kind of a wand or something the physician or the technician uses to guide this material. And again, it's the reactive oxygen species material that's going along for the ride with the iron oxide particles, which is what makes the magnetic thing work, as you say, get to the site of the fungus and infection. And again, as it said here at the end of the article, it just seems to kind of naturally glom on and penetrate that fungal biofilm and do its job by dispensing the reactive oxygen species, which they say absolutely destroys the fungal biofilm / infection. So pretty cool stuff.
I think any way of kind of treating diseases that we are all struggling with and just doing it faster, better, and this is obviously safer, you know, if you can use magnets and very specific chemicals instead of you know, just general antifungal creams and stuff like that.
Perfect.
This all sounds amazing. So Ralph, thank you for the stories. A lot of them were out there, but all of them are always a lot of fun. Ladies and gentlemen, if you want to find out more, computeramerica.com. We have a segment just for Ralph at the top of the page. And of course, we have his website in the show notes. And the show notes themselves has everything that we talked about. So Ralph, thank you for coming on. Everyone else, thank you for joining us. We'll see you here next time. Everyone, have a great weekend. Do something fun. Catch you next time. Bye-bye, everyone.